Welcome back, listener, to another edition of the Coco and Daltz podcast. Coco is laughing at me. Why are you laughing at me?
You have a very different approach to the intro than I do.
Yes, I do. Well, that's what makes us distinct people. We are our separate and own people.
And that's why I'm not Daltz.
And I'm not Coco. And you know what we do? We review movies. We're real people doing real reviews. Because I forgot to do that last time. And then you put it on the end. And because you're a nice person and you didn't nag me about it. It's like, you forgot to do the thing. So I did it this time.
Well, like you said, we're different people.
We are different people. Hey, Coco, what are we talking about in this episode of the podcast?
In this episode of the podcast, our 112th, if you're keeping score at home, or if you're alone, that's an old Letterman joke. Sorry about that.
I miss you, Letterman.
No kidding. So in the 112th episode of our podcast, we are talking about the HBO original documentary, The Bee Gees, How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? It dropped on December 11th, so it's been about 3 weeks now. It obviously talks about the Bee Gees, which I'm not going to tell you who they are because everybody in the freaking world knows the Bee Gees.
Right.
But it talks about their childhood in Australia, how they ended up in England, how, like, their musical background, how they ended up with a recording contract, all the way through their early years of their career, then kind of like a mid-career malaise, and then at the end of their career, global superstardom craziness with the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack, and then the slump after that when there was the disco backlash and how they kind of refound their groove as songwriters for other artists. And, you know, it talked about their personal lives and stuff in there as well. And there was also a little bit. There were interviews with other artists, which I know we'll talk about, but there were also interviews with like a professor of musicology, I think from London, and then a house producer talking about kind of like the history of disco and what led to the backlash against it and stuff like that. And I thought those segments were really interesting. So before we talk about what I think about this documentary, Daltz, what did you think about this?
I loved it.
You did not. Be quiet.
I thought it was the best thing I've ever seen. No, I actually enjoyed it, but I didn't enjoy it as much as I thought I would. And I didn't. I think that there were some things left on the table. So, for example, there is no explanation whatsoever in terms of why they are called the Bee Gees.
Right.
Which is kind of a fundamental thing if you're going to do a profile on a group. And it's not exactly the most important thing because some names are just thrown out there and some names are like record producers come up with the names and do a market study and all that sort of stuff. But in this instance, it's kind of interesting because I had to look it up and the crack research staff looked it up for me. I don't want to take their credit. There's this belief that it was because Barry Gibb is one of the members. So they were called the Bee Gees because of Barry Gibb or because of Brothers Gibb. Apparently, neither one of these are true, and it's because one of the first promoters that they had, his initials were BG, and then the guy that they hired to promote them was also a BG, and then alongside Barry Gibb, they thought, well, there's three BGs here, let's call them the BGs. And
I always thought it was Brothers Gibb.
Right.
Like, yeah, so that was complete news to me when Daltz said, hey, look what our crack research team just handed me about why they're called the Bee Gees. Why wasn't this included in the documentary?
We were sitting at news desks like they do on Saturday Night Live, and they're just, this just in, this right. research paper. So there are a couple of things like that. It's a little bit on the puffy side. Like, I think it's a lot of Bee Gees people were involved in the production and that sort of thing. So those always are a little bit softball-y. But at the same time, I thought it was interesting because there was some very interesting stuff that I learned about them. I knew that they were kind of a skiffle band in the olden days, and they were sort of like the Beatles when the Beatles were around. But I think there was a lot of information about that time that I hadn't seen before. And then also the Saturday Night Fever album and the level of success and the sort of the unprecedented sales that it had, that was sort of reinforced to me. I sort of knew a little bit about that because I was living in those days. Mm-hmm. But It was very interesting. And then seeing, you know, the rifts between the brothers, that was also interesting as well. So there's some, you think of the Bee Gees and you think of harmony, both in terms of their voices and in terms of them getting along. But of course, any group is going to have that kind of conflict, especially if you've been singing together since you were like wee laddies. Mm-hmm. So what did you think, Coco?
Yeah, that was, I don't really know if I knew about the conflicts either. Some of the artist interviews that were included were Noel Gallagher and Nick Jonas of the Jonas Brothers. They were specifically talking about what it's like to be in a group with your family members.
Yeah.
And I could listen to Noel Gallagher talk all day because I love Oasis.
I was just going to say that. Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought those interviews really added to it because mm-hmm. you've got the professional conflicts that also have family conflict undertones to them as well.
Yep.
So that I think that's something that like a lot of people don't really appreciate. I had freaking no idea that the Bee Gees existed before disco. Like I'm not going to lie. I love disco music. I understand it's disco music, but mm-hmm. it's fun. It's just something to listen yeah. to when you're working out or when you're in the car mm-hmm. and it's not trying to be anything. It's not. It's just, you know, fun, happy dance music. So I love Disco Forever is one of my go-to playlists on Spotify. And I had freaking no clue that the Bee Gees had anything beyond disco.
Yeah.
So everything pre like 1974 to me was brand new information. Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of their music was actually really good, and then some of it was just kind of like, eh, mm-hmm. you know, whatever.
Sort of the time, though, too. I mean, yeah. they were saying at one point they made 3 albums in 1 year. I mean,
right.
you're making 3 albums in a year? That's not going to be gold music every time.
Right, totally. And it did really kind of have that, like, early to mid-60s, like, Laurel Canyon
right.
kind of London pop vibe to it. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I was like, wow, this does not sound like you should be dancing at all.
Very folky. And there was a lot of Beatles influence. And like you said, yeah. like the, you know, the Jefferson Airplane and stuff mm-hmm. like that.
Yeah. So I enjoyed it because I never knew any of that stuff. And when it was also talking about their sort of 80s and 90s resurgence as songwriters for other artists, mm-hmm. like they wrote Islands in the Stream.
Right.
Who the hell knew that? Right. I always assumed that Dolly wrote that because Dolly writes everything. But I was like, what the
yeah.
actual F? Like
yeah.
there was apparently, yeah, they've written thousands of songs for other artists. So that was also news to me because, you know, after Saturday Night Fever in the late 70s, I mean, in pop culture consciousness, broadly, they just kind of dropped off, at least
right.
here in the States.
Yeah.
So.
Well, and they did largely, too. Like, they said that, honestly, on the documentary, is that they couldn't get back on radio. Once the
right.
disco inferno burned out, and they couldn't, and nobody was buying disco record, you know, quote-unquote disco records anymore, they couldn't get back on the air. And so they just ended up writing songs for other people, which I thought was a really good idea. Really, they still had a lot of those songs. Like, you could tell there was a Dionne Warwick song that she was singing. It sounded like a Bee Gees song.
Right, totally.
Like, she was singing it in her voice and her style and everything like that. But you could imagine the Bee Gees mm-hmm. singing that song.
Yeah. And a Barbra Streisand song as well.
Right.
Like, and they had a clip of them on, you know, like Tom Snyder or something. And he was
right.
like, is it difficult to write, you know, for women? And they were like, no, like it's good. We're fine.
Right.
Like, you know, we just
kind
do
of a
it.
Stupid question.
Right. Totally. So I actually came out of this with a new appreciation for them because mm-hmm. I never knew any of that other stuff about them. I felt really bad for Barry Gibb. He's the mm-hmm. lone remaining brother. Andy, Robin, and Morris all passed between 88 and like 2012. And, you know, at the end, he's like, yeah, we had our differences, but I would trade all our number one hits and all our career, you know, accolades and everything just to have them all back. And I'm
yeah.
like, yeah, I bet.
Yeah. It was kind of sad in that way because those guys, they didn't, especially Robin and Barry, didn't really get along all that well. And you could
yeah.
tell,
mm-hmm.
like, it was very obvious after they mentioned that a couple of times in the documentary. And kudos to them for actually talking about this stuff.
Right.
Because it's not easy, you know, airing your family laundry in public, right?
Mm.
And they did it as classily and cagely as possible. But you could tell there's certain scenes where Barry, they're all on stage together and there's the three of them right there. And you can tell that Barry is not looking at Robin and Robin's not
mm-hmm.
looking at Barry, or they're looking past each other as
yeah.
they're doing these things. And that was really insightful. I mean, it's hard for me not to like a documentary about modern music.
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be pretty awful for me not to like it. And I like this one. I, again, it was a little bit soft, but really it was informative. And you, the whole idea of coming out of a documentary is you've got to learn something.
Right.
You'd be entertained and you'd be informed. And I think we were for this particular one.
Yeah, if there were a couple things I would change. So it was an hour and like 45, 50 minutes long. I definitely, even though I realize this is a Bee Gees specific documentary and not a history of disco documentary, I would have added an extra 10 or 15 minutes of those two guys I mentioned earlier talking about the history of disco, and this is how the backlash started. And there was also, they interviewed Charlie Steiner, who was a DJ at a New York radio station in the late 70s, and he was talking about how it sucked because, you know, four songs out of like 10 that you would play in an hour were Bee Gees songs, and even if you didn't dislike the Bee Gees, you did if you were a DJ because that's all you ever heard. So I would have been interested in hearing like more from those three guys.
Right.
And then also I mentioned the Noel Gallagher and Nick Jonas interviews, which I definitely appreciate that they were included from the family, you know, aspect. But there were also interviews with Chris Martin and Justin Timberlake, and I didn't feel like those added anything to the documentary.
Yeah.
Like, I understand, like, maybe they want to get a wide variety of artists talking about this is, you know, how the Bee Gees influenced me or whatever, but they weren't really doing that. It was just JT saying, like, the Bee Gees are freaking awesome, man.
Yeah.
And, you know, and Chris Martin did have one clip where he was talking about how artists today know that the backlash is going to come, but maybe artists back in the 60s and 70s, backlashes weren't as much of a thing.
Because rock and roll was new in those days.
Yeah. So, but I was like, I'm sure you could have gotten like Noel Gallagher to talk about the backlash that Oasis got after their first two albums were so massive. So I was like, you know, the Chris Martin and JT interviews didn't add anything whatsoever to me.
Yeah. I agree with that. I think that Chris Martin, he's such an affable guy, and I think that his star power, and the same with Justin Timberlake, they wanted to include these guys and, you know, voices including Justin Timberlake and Chris Martin and Noel Gallagher. But yeah, you're right. I think Noel Gallagher, I could listen to him talk all day about,
oh my God, me too,
about rock and roll and brothers and everything like that, because he's so honest and he's so smart that he just brings the unvarnished truth, and I really like that about him. But yeah, it was that was a little bit extra. I think that the whole aspect of the disco blazing out, that part of it was really well handled, and it was really creatively done because they juxtaposed a concert that the Bee Gees were having at the time with the infamous Comiskey Park Burn Your Disco Records, Blow Them Up promotion that ended up getting a Major League Baseball game canceled, forfeited. So that I thought that was really well done, and it was a little bit different. So that I think the filmmakers really tried to do the best they could, and they used archival footage from the two deceased members of the Bee Gees, and to great effect. You know, they didn't just include things for the sake of including it. I thought it was pretty effective. They used the widows pretty well. So I think it was, they did a really good job at trying to be as complete as possible.
And they even interviewed Eric Clapton.
Right.
Because when the Bee Gees first started going disco, they stayed in the house that Clapton stayed at when he went to Miami to like get his career back on track after his addiction. So I was like, oh my God, you're interviewing Eric Clapton. Like, and so that one I enjoyed as well.
Right.
Like that was,
and he also introduced them to a studio and a producer.
Yeah.
And like, there's things that he helped with, you know, he says it jokingly at one time, he's like, I can take credit for all of this, all of their success because it's because of that one recommendation I had. But it was really well done, well-rounded and informative.
Produced and I believe directed by Frank Marshall.
Yes.
So,
yes.
I mean, it's not Coco and Daltz doing a documentary on the Bee Gees, and you know,
well,
it's
you can
like,
imagine how that would go.
Right. It's like the when George Lucas first mocked up Star Wars, and you can see like the bad like special effects that he did with like his camcorder at home, and like the opening scroll is like wavy across the screen.
Right.
Like that would be Coco and Daltz doing a documentary on the Bee Gees.
I think you're giving us short shrift on that. We would do a spectacular job. Well, it would just be essentially this podcast.
Right. In video form.
In video form.
Netflix, call us.
Please do.
So what would you give the Bee Gees, How Can You Mend a Broken Heart?
So I'm going to change my rating system because this is the new year and because it wasn't really working, the old one. I'm going to give this probably like a 7 out of 10.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. 7 out of 10. Really, really complete, but didn't go over the top. You know, it wasn't fantastic. What's your rating on this one, Coco?
I'd give it a B.
Yeah, a solid B.
Yeah, a solid B.
Yeah.
Maybe a B plus if I'm feeling generous, but definitely a B for sure.
Would you give it a B and a G?
B to the power of G.
B to the power of G.
Yeah.
That's already got my brain hurting thinking about algebra.
Yeah, me too.
Well, that's it for another edition of the podcast, listener. Unless you had something else to add, Coco.
No, that's it. Just go find the Bee Gees' How Can You Mend a Broken Heart on HBO Max.
And also go to CocoandDolls.com and click on the contribute to the podcast link. And then just what you should do is just put in the largest number you can type in and then just send it.
We'd appreciate that. I mean, we're making a whole lot of money from sponsorships and stuff, but,
right.
You know, we can always use more.
Well, yeah, exactly.
I mean, more, as Andrea True said in a disco classic.
Wow. Look at you.
I told you I like disco.
So this is bringing it all back together again. So we should just end the podcast because you just completely encapsulated it.
All right. So for another episode, I'm not Dalt.
And I'm not Coco.